ever wondered how the world came to be or how it will end? These are all questions that you will ask at some point within your lifetime. How did we get here? This question has been asked for millions and millions of years. And beyond all of those years, we've only come to one small pseudo-explanation for that, and that is mythology. So we ask ourselves, what exactly is mythology? Mythology is a collection of myths, especially one belonging to a particular religious or cultural tradition that is studied. So when we take a deeper look at what mythology is, its categories, its subcategories, its major regions of myths, its players of myths, and the cultural similarities that connect us all throughout this entire world, we might find an answer to one of those questions that has plagued humanity for its entire existence. But my speech is not about answering those questions, because I cannot answer those questions for you or anyone else. I'm not qualified. My speech is to simply teach you about one subcategory of that mythology. Mythology is a vast subject in its entirety. We have African mythology with its Bantu, Bushangu, Balubi, Babudi, Lugbara mythologies. Then we have our Arctic with the Finnish, Inuit, Norse, and Sami. Then we have our classical antiquities, the Greek, Roman, Etruscan, Paleo, Balkans, and Lusitanians, or however you say it. However, where do we start? I believe we're going to start in the Bronze Age with the Proto-Indian European, the Mesopotamian, Persian, Canaanite, Hittite, Iranian, Rigvedic, Chinese, and Egyptian mythology. All of these mythologies represent some kind of religious beliefs or ideologies of how we became to be as a human race. Before we get into the story of Egyptian mythology and how they believe we came to be, it's important that we understand what the gods are and what their roles were in their religion. So I found a wonderful picture that describes it closer to our central Christian Baptist religious views. This shows the skies and the heaven, the archangels, the Lord, the Holy Spirit, Jesus, and Satan. So we have all of these gods. We have Nut, the goddess of the sky. We have Tefnut, the goddess of the moisture. Shu, the god of air, and Geb, the god of earth. They are the skies and the heavens that have built this entire planet, the earth, and everything. Then we have our archangels that are basically the right hand of our Holy Spirit, Amun, Ra, Amun. And Ra actually has four different forms. He has the morning, Amun Ra, the afternoon, Kep Ra, Karak Ra, which is the evening, and then Ekrem Ra, which is the night. We have Jesus, which is Osiris, Ptah and Thoth. Ptah, Sefer, and Ptah, Apis. Ptah is the god of glory and glorified war. Then we have Satan, Seth, and Apep, and then the band and associated with Satan, which would be his right-hand demons, Hathon and Nefertum. While we have descriptions of them, let's start with the skies in heaven. As I went over, Nut is the sky goddess, Tefnut, the goddess of moisture, Shu helped hold the figure of Nut up so that the earth, Geb, and Nut would be separated. Then we have Geb, who was the husband of Nut and the father of Osiris, Isis, Nephthys, and Seth, all very important gods in their religious circle. We have the archangels, Mentu, the hot god of war, Mut, the primal deity associated with waters from which everything was born, also known as Nun, which is the waters of chaos. We have Wajit, who represented Lower Egypt, the lower class. Bastet, which is usually a protective goddess representative of the cat, also represented Upper Egypt, the higher class of society. That's why cats and other animals were mostly revered as gods. Then we have Sekhmet, the goddess of war, also known as the powerful one. So within all of these gods that we have even the demons, angels that were cast down in a glorified war. Seth represented everything that threatened harmony. We have Apep, who was an opponent of light, and Ma'at, which is the order or truth. We have Hathor, the wife of Horus and the mother of Pharaoh. She's the goddess of foreign places, and foreign in Egypt is classified as evil because it is not of them. We have Nefertum, which represented the Egyptian blue lotus flower, basically euphoria, which was seen as a sin. So after going through that, we have the Holy Spirit, Amun. And Amun and Ra are not entirely separate beings, but they show up in several different hieroglyphic eras. And it is later described that Ra has four different forms. We'll go into that later. So the important part of this is a story. A long time ago, there was waters of chaos known as Nun. Eventually from them rose a mountain called Binbin. That was the official mountain, the start of life as we knew it. And among the top of that mountain was Ra, Amun-Ra. And he coughed out Shu and Tefnut, the god of air and the goddess of moisture. Tefnut and Shu eventually had children. They had Geb and Nut. They created the earth as they were. Geb is the earth, Nut is the sky, being held up by Shu. Nut and Geb had a child, Osiris, a couple of children, Osiris, Isis, Seth, and Nephthys. Seth eventually grew angry over the fact that Osiris was the king of the world that was brought about. Isis was the queen, and Nephthys was the guardian of the underworld. So Seth had no power. He was just there. He became very jealous and resentful towards Osiris, and eventually he took and killed Osiris, taking care of his entirety and taking over his place as king of the earth. Then we had Osiris is now the king of the underworld. Osiris had a child with Isis while he was in the underworld, and he came out and his name was Horus. Horus took revenge for his father and killed Seth, damning him to damnation in the underworld. Horus was now the king of Earth, Osiris the king of the underworld, Nephthys the guardian of Seth, and Isis was now the queen of her son, Horus, and they later had more children. Among all of this glory and holy war in Egyptian mythology, Geb and Nut went lost. Earth ceased to exist. During that time, Ra sent out his eye, Wajib, to find these important gods that created the earth. And whenever Wajib returned and said, "I have found them," he wept tears of joy, and thus humans were born from his tears. In Egyptian mythology, we are imagined as a tear coming from a god's eye, representative of something great and powerful and important. But the real fact of the matter is this is just one myth. This is one giant mythology aspect that covers all of this and it tells of our creation. And then you go over to Christianity or Hinduism or any Islam, and they all have their bounds of how we were created, what our morals are, and everything like that. So whether or not we can find an answer to those questions that were posed at the beginning of my speech is unknown, because it's all based on myths. But if we focus on those similarities, there is a chance that we might be able one day, not in my lifetime, surely, but one day to be able to answer those questions that have plagued humanity for their entire existence.